Let's say I'm working on a character animator project with this frog, and someone asked me to make the frog hop back and forth around the scene. So there's a few ways I could go about doing that. Number one would be adding draggable handles to the different parts of the frog, and then having him jump around like that. But I can only control one dragger at a time, so if I want his arms to be swinging around while I'm jumping or anything else like that, any variation to the legs, I don't have that level of control with this. Or I could turn on full body motion tracking and do the jumping myself, but that's going to require me to be a little bit more coordinated than I am, and it still doesn't have the precision that I'm looking for. Or if I had the character animator public beta, I could go into the new motion library behavior, select the jump category, find hop back and forth, and apply a pre-made animation to my frog character to start jumping around the scene. So the jumping is a great start, but maybe in the next scene, the character is doing a little song and dance number and I want a breakdancing frog now. So again, that'd be difficult to do if I was just doing the draggers or the full body animation, but I could go into motion library, find the dance category, and go up to breakdance uprock, and now I have the beginnings of a breakdancing frog. And then maybe after all this jumping and dancing, my frog just wants to stand still and listen to another character talking. And so let's go into the idle category and just do breathe idle 2. And now my character just has kind of this nice breathing up and down motion that I can use for when the character is standing still. So this is a new feature we're adding into the Adobe Character Animator beta program today. It's called Motion Library, and basically it is a group of over 350 pre-made animations that you can add to your characters to have them do things like jump, fight, dance, breathe, and all sorts of other different things. So these pre-made animations actually came from another Adobe product, Mixamo, which is used for 3D characters and animation. And they've got a great expansive library of different things that characters can do. And so we took that data and brought it in and applied it to 2D characters. So in this video, we're going to walk through how the motion library works and give you a preview of all the different things you can do, whether it's changing parameters, recording things, applying it to your own puppets, all of that sort of thing. So you can start to get familiar with it and play around with it, and then let us know, give us feedback about what's working and what isn't, so we can tweak it before we bring it out to the full shipping version of Character Animator. As usual, we've put together a small website that talks a little bit more about this feature in detail and has free example puppets that you can download and try out, as well as more information about how to join the beta of Character Animator if you haven't done that already. So to walk through the basics of Motion Library, I'm going to use this really simple stick figure character. He's available for free on the website, so you can check out and walk through it with me if you'd like to. But let's look at his motion library down here. So his first parameter down here says motion, and there's a couple of arrows and then a drop-down menu. So if I click on this drop-down menu, I've got all these different categories for the 350 different moves that my character can do. So idle, walk, run, dance, fight, jump, sports, and gesture. So this helps you, you know, kind of categorize the different things your character might be doing. And I like to start with dance. I think that's one of the most fun ones to kind of play around with. So let's go to dance and select saying like hip hop dance number 3. And once I've selected it, that is the active move, the active motion that this character is doing. And so he will immediately start doing those motions. If I want to browse more in a list or before or after, I can just use these little arrow keys to cycle to the next one. So here's hip hop dance 4 and 5 and 6 and then 7, and it keeps on going, or I can go back and check out some of the earlier ones as well. So that's a really easy way to try a bunch of dances quickly and see which one is looking best for your character. Under that, you've got a speed control. And so you can make, if this dance is too fast to your liking, I could move this down and just drag it to something like, let's say 54. And now he's gonna be moving a lot slower. Maybe I wanna time this to the beat of music or something like that, and I could get the timing exactly right so it's going to fit with that. Or of course I could go higher and then he's dancing like a complete maniac, and you could do that as well. The next two parameters are orientation and preferred orientation. And these are basically tools for fine tuning the animation to your own character. So we know that not all characters are going to be viewed the same, right? So this character is a front facing character, but you might have a character that's a quarter turn or a side profile view or something like that. And all these animations have their own kind of default orientation that they're set up as. Not all of them are front forward facing. So it's a bit of a black box, and not everything is every animation is going to always fit your character perfectly, but we do give you some tools at your disposal to try to tweak it a little to see if you can get it right. So for example, here's a sad idle animation from a character, and he's obviously kind of looking down and kicking his feet, being a little down on his luck. But the way that the head is bending, if I was front facing, this feels a little bit off. This feels a little bit weird. So I might play with the orientation dial here and just change it slightly. And if I do that, I see that the head is starting to tilt up a little bit more. So it looks like my character is kind of more forward facing and still kicking. So this looks a little bit better to me, and I might tweak it a little bit more if I wanted to. Also, you can uncheck preferred orientation if you want to and just do something like that. In general, unchecking preferred orientation is almost always going to make it forward facing as its default. So you can think of it like, let's say I've got Iron Man here. And he's forward facing. This is 0%, right? But as I start to turn, you know, negative 45% or 90% or so on, I'm tweaking the way that that animation is being added to my character. So a word of warning, not every animation is going to look 100% great on every character. There's just some animations that might not be the best match for your character given the way they're facing or their body type, sometimes more squat, shorter characters or different limbed characters. Cartoon characters, it can have all sorts of proportions, right? And so sometimes it might not translate perfectly, but you might get a little more, be able to tweak things to fit your character slightly better if you play around with orientation and preferred orientation. So it's kind of a trial and error process to see if you can make things work better or for your character, but it's worth checking out and playing around with. The next parameter, mirror, is going to do exactly what it says. So right now my character is kicking to his right side, but if I wanted him to kick to his left side instead, I just click mirror and that's just going to mirror the animation. So this is helpful if you want a character facing a certain way. For example, the punch, the fighting moves and things like that. If you want him to kick to the right or the left side, you can click mirror and that will help. Next, we've got root position, and I think the walk and run animations are the best place to show this. So you'll notice by default, this is set at reset at loop. And so what happens when my character starts walking? I've got walk one selected here. It's going to reset. So there's basically this, you know, 2 or 3 seconds that the character is moving, and then it resets back at the beginning. But I've got a few other options. For example, continuous. What's going to happen there? He's just going to keep walking until he goes off the screen. So if I want to bring him back, I just click reset position down here, and that's going to bring him back to the zero position before he goes off again. So it's not that great for previewing things, but in your actual animation that you're doing, if you want a character to walk from one side of the screen to the other, this might be the best way to do it. Your final option is treadmill. And what this is gonna do is not have any horizontal movement to the character at all. It's as if he was on a treadmill, just kind of walking in place or running in place or whatever it is. So this is good if you had your background moving instead and you want your character to stay centered, you could do a type of animation like this. So you can play around with this to get some really interesting effects. So right now my character feels like they're kind of sidestepping, moving to the side like a crab or something like that. But if I uncheck preferred orientation or I played around with the orientation dial here, now my character's kind of as if he was walking forward, you know, kind of. So this is a more forward facing view. And this would work if I, you know, had the background kind of scaling back and he's walking up a road or something like that towards the camera. Something like this might work a lot better. So it's fun to kind of play around with these different parameters all together and see what interesting combinations you can get. The next section is tracked handles. And basically this is showing me which tagged parts of my character where I in the rigging said, here's the shoulder, the elbow, the knees, the neck, all of that stuff. What's being controlled by the motion library animations? So here I'm doing a salsa dance and it looks like most of the things by default are being controlled by motion library. That includes the head, the knees, all of that stuff. But if I turn my head right now, you'll see I have absolutely no control over the character's head movements because these are all being controlled by the motion library, a motion instead. But if I uncheck these, now I have head control back and I can move it around. So I could do the same thing if I want to control one of the arms or I want to control a leg or for some reason I don't like how, you know, the waist is moving. I can uncheck these things and try to do more custom performance capture or dragger or whatever type of behavior performances you want to add on top of it. Now, sometimes you may see emotion and feel like it's a little too strong for what it's doing. For example, this character's legs, they're just kicking up way too high and it just doesn't work for this orientation. One thing I can do is actually not in the motion library behavior, but in the body behavior. The strength of the body behavior will actually control the strength of these different motions. So if I bring this down slightly to 76 or something like that, now the legs are looking a little bit better and I could bring it even down much further so it's barely happening and the character just gets kind of bouncing along. So this is another parameter you can play around with. Okay, so now that we know the basics of how to play around with these things, what would we do to actually record them into our timeline? And luckily, it's a really simplified process. So let's go ahead. I always like starting with an idle animation, an animation that is just what's happening when my character isn't doing anything else. So let's go into motion here and let's select idle and let's go to breathe idle 2. That's my go-to. And that's looking nice. That's just her breathing kind of heavily after, okay, I just did this big dance move where I'm about to begin. And all I have to do is not even worry about this red record dot like I normally do. See this little button here, record one motion. If I click on that, it's gonna record basically one loop of that motion that I have. And some of those might be a second or two, some of those might be 10 seconds. It all depends on how long that animation motion is. So what I'm gonna do is drag this to the beginning and just drag it out for the duration of this particular scene. So you can actually, even though it's recording one motion and saying, oh, this is only 4 or 5 seconds, you can make it as short or as long as you want. And you'll see as I scrub through here, she's still doing her breathing for the entire time. So really all the bar is saying is keep moving, keep showing this as long as the bar is going, depending on the parameters. So if I set the speed to slower or the orientation different or the root position, all those things are going to be baked in to the actual recording. So now that we've got our idle animation down, let's layer over top of it with some dance moves. So I'm going to select a dance and let's start with a hip hop dance. Let's do hip hop dance 2, something like that. And I'm just gonna again, click record one motion. And there it goes, it shows up. And I can blend this by clicking the edges, the blend handles just as usual to blend from that idle animation into this hip hop dance. So blending works, it's just like any other take. You can seamlessly add multiple performances together and then blend them together to look like everything's working seamlessly. Now it can be kind of confusing as you're playing around with this, as I'm going around the timeline, well, what am I seeing right now? I'm not seeing what's in the timeline. I'm seeing what the live view, in essentially rehearsing, getting ready for a live performance. So there's a few things you can do. The best, easiest way is to just click the red dot next to your character in the timeline. That's the best way to move between your live data and your recorded data. So now that the red dot is off, I can play this back and I can see my character just moving between the timeline data there. And now she moves seamlessly from the breathe animation into the hip hop dance. And when I'm ready to record more, I'll just click the red dot again. That makes my character armed for recording. And let's just pick another one, hip hop dance 4. Let's add that in there. Again, record one motion. Move down a little bit. Let's do another one. Hip hop dance 6. That looks good. And let's just say that I'm pretty happy with. So you can see how easy it is to quickly continually add these different movements. And then I'm just gonna continually blend them one over top of another, something like this. And maybe I'll change the timing so these are a little bit shorter, something like that, move this over. Okay, and now let's disarm the character and play this back and see how it looks. So she's breathing at first, she's doing one of her hip hop moves, then she moves into the other one. Now she's starting to do that last hip hop move and then she's gonna go back to her breathing animation. So you can string a bunch of things together. It doesn't matter if it's dance moves, fight moves, different sports moves, gestures as the character's talking. In general, I think this is the best way to go. Put that one track as long as you can for your idle animation and then build these other things on top of it. And it's okay to have some gaps too, So maybe she dances a little bit and goes back to her idle animation and then dances again or makes gestures or whatever you want. So you've played around with these example characters and now you want to add motion library to your own characters. How do you go about doing that? Well, you basically follow the exact same steps as rigging for body tracking. So if you need a refresher on that, check out the body tracking tutorial that we have up and that will go into detail about how to do all the rigging for that. But one specific point you need to worry about is you want to have your body, limb IK, and motion library behaviors all on the same level. And typically that's gonna be the root level of the puppet up here. So remember to add an extra behavior to here. You can either click the plus button that shows up over here or your behaviors over here on the right-hand side and add that new motion library to it and make sure that the body, limb IK, and motion library behaviors are all there because they all kind of work together with each other. And then from there, the body tracking tutorial should hopefully go into greater detail, but the main things you gotta worry about are make sure you have all these body tags showing up. So I've got my shoulders, my hips, my neck, and my waist. Waist in particular is not something that is that critical for body tracking, but it actually makes a huge difference when you are doing motion library. So make sure to add that in. And then my arms, I've got the elbow and wrist on either arm tagged, as well as in the legs. I've got the knee, heel, and toe. Don't worry about the ankle, it's not needed. Knee, heel, and toe here as well on the right side. Another really fun thing you can do with these is add them to triggers, make replays and triggers. So you can have a dance move at your disposal anytime you press a button. So let's say, for example, I like this dance move for this character and I want it to show up whenever I press the one key. So really easy to set up. I'm gonna go ahead, record one motion here. I'm gonna then click this so it goes back to none. So I'm only seeing what's in the timeline down here. Let's press plus a couple of times to zoom in. And I'll just add a little bit of blend on the beginning and end. Then we'll right click it, create replay and trigger. That's gonna add a replay to our little library down here. Stop sustain replay is exactly what I want. And now it shows up in my triggers panel. We'll latch it and we will type a one here. So this is all basic trigger stuff covered in a lot of different videos. But now you can see I've got my character, I'm doing whatever I want with it. And then when I press one, suddenly he goes into that dance move. And it's gonna go on for as long as I need it to be, not necessarily the 4 or 5 seconds that I've got here. Remember, that thing can go and stretch as long as I need. So he could be dancing for 5 minutes like this if he really wanted to. And then when I'm done, I just press one and he goes back to his default view. So you might wanna put a bunch of these in a swap set. So for example, have one idle animation that's your default and have that always be the one that it goes back to and blends into, and then all your other dance moves over top of that or whatever moves, fighting moves, you could set up a ninja with all sorts of, fighting stances or a sports character that's doing a bunch of moves or just a regular talking character that's idle and then just has a bunch of basic gestures that go over top of it. So there's a lot of really cool possibilities here and especially fun for live characters. You could add a bunch of these into a character while you're doing a live stream and just have them start dancing or fighting or doing whatever you want. So that's motion library. And the thing I love most about this behavior is how it brings your characters to life in new and unexpected ways. So even older characters I've been testing this on, some of the robot and monster characters I used to make, they are coming to life in all new ways that I never thought was possible. To see these characters dancing and fighting and doing different walk and run animations or idle animation, it's bringing them to life in a completely new way. And with 350 moves, there's something for everyone. And it's a lot of fun to just kind of go through them and experiment and see which ones work best and kind of come up with some story ideas for, okay, maybe in my next cartoon, I could add a dance scene or a fight scene or, add these running away scenes, whatever sorts of things you want. They feel a lot more attainable now. And that's always been a goal of Character Animator, is to make the world of animation more accessible to a wider audience. So hopefully we're on the right track, but if we are, if we aren't, we'd love to hear your feedback. So please use that website. There is a link to our beta feedback form there, and that is the best place to let us know what you think we still need to work on or what's working great or any other ideas you might have for where we could expand this to in the future. And if you make anything cool with Motion Library, we'd love to see it. Please use hashtag Character Animator when sharing on social media so myself and the team can check it out. All right, that's it for this preview. Have fun checking out Motion Library, and we'll see you next time.